गुड इवनिंग सर, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। कैन यू पुट ऑन द ऑडियोज एंड वीडियोज ऑफ ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट? या सो गुड इवनिंग सर, एंड दिस इज द सेकेंड एडिशन ऑफ अवर ऑक्यू हेल्थ स्केप्स, एंड इन विच विल बी डिस्कसिंग द मंथ लॉन्ग वॉट एवर ऑक्यूपेशन हेल्थ things have happened, what are important things which have been there in the last 1 month since we had this last health escape issues. And for this our learned speaker is Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain, our senior vice president from AUSD, that is IUS Delhi branch. And for all the participants and Dr. Rajiv sir, actually Dr. Gajendra Kumar, he is engaged in one exigency of official exigency, so he will be joining late. So you can start, sir. Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain, sir.
Good evening, friends. Today's OCU Healthscapes would like to cover certain areas which have happened in the last 1 month in the area of occupational health and environmental health. As we go along, we will realize every month something new keeps happening. But what has continued to engage our attention has been the COVID-19 pandemic, including the new intervention, that is the vaccines, which would protect us against severe COVID-19. Now, in that context, let us see what is the current global situation of COVID-19 pandemic in the world. So for that purpose, we shall first visit the WHO coronavirus dashboard. This is the latest position in terms of total cases cumulative total per million population, cases newly reported 7 days, and cases reported in last 24 hours. I've arranged this table in order of cases newly reported in last 24 hours. In last 24 hours, 5,87,000 cases were reported, out of which the highest number were reported by USA, that is 1,55,000. And Brazil, 63,500, and France, number third, 26,000, the United Kingdom, 25,000, Russia, 19,000, India, 18,800,
and Mexico. Sir, please share your screen, sir. Screen is not visible, sir.
Right. Yeah. Yes, I shall do that.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Now, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
It is visible to all?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is the coronavirus dashboard. As I was saying, 5,87,000 cases by total all over the world last 24 hours, out of which 1.55 lakh cases by USA, Brazil 63,000, France 26,000, UK 25,000, Russia 19,000, India 18,000, and Mexico 17,900, in that order. But if you see cases in per million population, while USA has 76,597, Brazil has 42,000, India only has 7,700. So amongst all the countries, India is the lowest. If you see per million population. This month, it was crucial that the world crossed 100 million cases and USA crossed 25 million cases. So in terms of cases, USA still continues maximum cases in 24 hours, in 7 days, and overall total in the world. And its overall incidence in terms of per million population is also by far the highest. Now let us see the situation of deaths. I've arranged this table again in terms of deaths newly reported in the last 24 hours. If you see, 16,000 deaths were reported last 24 hours, 4,000 deaths by USA, Brazil 1283, UK 1725, Mexico 1623, and Russia 575, France 349, and India only 163. Here again, if you see amongst these countries, if you look at per million population cumulative deaths, the world average is 278.7, while USA has 1286, Brazil has 1,035, France has 1134, UK has 1500, which is higher than USA in terms of deaths. 490 is Russia, and Mexico is 1191, and India is only 111.6, which is by far much, much below the highest, that is UK. And to amongst total deaths that have been reported, that is 2 million, more than 2 million cases, 2 million deaths, highest has been USA, that is 421,670. And Brazil 220,000, and UK 101,000. India though 154,000, but Mexico 153,000, such a small country. The average per million population is quite low in India. Let us see the situation in India broadly, and then micro level state-wise in its real situation. India has reported 10.72 million cases and 1,54,000 deaths, 1,69,000 active cases at the moment, 18,900 cases last 24 hours, and 162 deaths yesterday. India tested 7.4 lakh tests yesterday. 7-day average test positivity rate at the moment is only 1.8. Cases are growing at 0.12%, which is very, very, very low if you see entire country. And in addition, the new area of vaccination, 2.85 million vaccinations have been done so far. We look at the condition of confirmed cases. Kerala has reported the maximum 5,700, Maharashtra 2,800, and all other states have reported less than 1,000 cases in the last 24 hours. So Kerala and Maharashtra continue to report substantial number of cases. Maharashtra deaths still continue to be high, 50, and Kerala still deaths continue to be high at 19. All the states are reporting less than 10 deaths per day. But if you look at the tests, while actually Maharashtra and Kerala should be at the top in terms of tests per million per day, but Delhi is at the top, Pondicherry, Kerala has come up substantially in terms of testing. It is 1,649, but it has to scale up. Maharashtra still is testing less. If you look at the position, Maharashtra is testing 518 tests per million per day, though Indian average is 548. And it is the highest in the country in terms of deaths, and it is second highest in terms of cases reported. So Maharashtra, still there is an issue of number of tests. If you see at the test positivity rate percentage, out of 100 tests, 11 tests are still positive in Kerala. This is last 7 days average. So Goa and Maharashtra are still reporting 4.2 and Lakshadweep 2.5. Now 7 day average, if we look at the position in terms of growth, Kerala is 0.66 and Chhattisgarh 0.42, Gujarat 0.15, and Chandigarh 0.15, and Goa is 0.13. Though India average is 0.13, which is just equal to Maharashtra's current rate. So if we control the infection through active testing, Kerala, Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Chandigarh, Goa, and Maharashtra, there would be substantial gains for the future. Now, this is a visual where in terms of global COVID-19 deaths, we have reached a total of 17,000 deaths during on Wednesday, that is yesterday, and a new record for a single day fatality. It is yet another reminder of the devastating nature of the disease and how the pandemic go out of control if nations are not in control, not careful. Fatalities are rising at the fastest rate yet. Deaths reported across the world due to COVID has been shown in the graph at the top, starting from January 31 to January 27. Now, at the bottom blue color graph is the visual where contribution of deaths by each country in terms of proportion, in terms of percentages has been shown. This is during last week. What is shown here, that is half the world death in just five countries. What are those five countries? 24% United States, 9% is UK, 7% is Brazil, 5% is Germany, 4% is Russia, 3% is Italy, 3% is France, 3% is Spain, 1% is India, and 1% is Turkey. And 41% is contributed by rest of the world. That is the situation today. If you look at India, COVID deaths are substantially lower, but top states with COVID deaths last week have been Maharashtra 32%, Kerala 14%, Chhattisgarh 6%, Punjab 6%, West Bengal 6%, Delhi 5.6%, UP 4.6%, Tamil Nadu 4.4%, Madhya Pradesh 3.0%, Bihar 2.7%, and rest of the country 15%. That is the situation at the moment. Now, vaccination, this distribution will give you true picture of the current status of vaccination in India. If you look at the yellow dots, they are the total vaccinated number in each state, and the blue dots show the vaccinations yesterday. If you look at the figure all over the country, the highest number of vaccinations have been in Karnataka. If you look at Karnataka at the bottom, if you look at Karnataka, it is 2,84,000, which is almost 10% of Indian vaccinations all across the country. Maharashtra still has good number of vaccination, 2,22,000. Rajasthan has 2,44,000. UP has 2,94,000. And Madhya Pradesh has 1,67,000. And Bihar also has crossed 1 lakh. West Bengal is 187. Odisha 194. Telangana 151. Andhra Pradesh 170. Kerala 1,07,000. So these states are aggressively going ahead for vaccination of healthcare workers. Now you have to see this figure in relation to the number of healthcare workers registered on the COVID portal from each state. Currently, the highest number of healthcare workers registered in any state is in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, and then Maharashtra. And the way vaccination has been progressing is very, very positive, and it is actually trying to overcome vaccine hesitancy within the healthcare workers, including doctors, nurses, and other paramedical workers. And you also must realize in this figure that vaccine has reached the remotest corner of the country, right from Ladakh, Arunachal, Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram, Tripura, all these remote localities, northeastern and northern Ladakh. Also, the vaccine has reached and it's being administered to the healthcare workers in those states. So it is equitable and it is being given to the most vulnerable population at the moment and who require to be immunized. That is who have the highest susceptibility for severe COVID because of repeated exposure to COVID patients. That is the healthcare workers. This is actually happened. This is very heartening step and where healthcare workers have cooperated substantially. This is the graph. India becomes the sixth country in the world with 2 billion vaccine doses. And if you see, US has already vaccinated 23.5, Germany 2 million, UK 7.6, India 23.5 for yesterday, China 15 million. That is the condition, the color, green color shows the number of the way people have been vaccinated. If you look at the Indian graph on the right side, Ernakulam and Kozhikode have recorded the highest jump in cases, and Pune also is following Kozhikode and Ernakulam. So Pune in Maharashtra, Kozhikode and in Kerala, they are the highest focus of infection of COVID-19 today in our country. Kerala has accounted for nearly half of India's COVID death, as I told you earlier this week, and that is what is worrying, why and how they need to be understood and then corrective action taken. I would now like to like you to leave COVID-19 for the time being, and let us go to something which is very interesting, which has happened in the last 1 week. That is, this particular incident, which has made people see the facts in our country in this true context. That is the longitudinal aging study in India, where India has shown that we can study our own population of people who are aging, who have just crossed their active working lifespan and who are going into the second phase of their life, that is the post-work space of life, that is post 50 years. As this study has been done in Mumbai, coordinated by International Institute of Population Sciences, under the National Program for Health Care of the Elderly by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. This is the...
Your slides are not progressing, sir.
The slide is not visible?
No. After slide 8, it is not moving.
Screen is... this population, this is not visible?
No, sir.
My screen is being shared, no?
Screen is shared, but you are stuck at slide 8.
Okay. Now?
Now again you have to share the screen, sir.
All right. I'll do that. Yes. Right. Is it visible now?
Yes. Now right. It is.
Good. Thank you. This longitudinal aging study in India started in 2016, and now in 2021 January, first time the wave one report has been produced. Now this particular study, coordinated by NPHCE and Indian International Institute of Population Sciences, throws light on very crucial aspects of aging, and this gives an evidence as to what is happening in our country. Also, it is important to understand that this study has been done in collaboration with the University of South California and the Harvard T.N. Chan School of Public Health. So I'll show you very key findings which are relevant for occupational health practitioners in our country, because action will be required during the work-life period of these individuals, because that will determine the future of quality of aging in our country. Now, if you see globally, there is evidence, but in India, there was never any evidence as to how aging population is evolving in our country and what are their problems. And we also know that by the year 2050, global life expectancy is to reach 75 years for males and 79 years for females. And with 1.36 billion inhabitants in India, it will become the world's most populous country in next 6 years. And if you look at the proportion of people who are elderly, will account for 8.6 to 103 million elderly population. It will rise further to 19.5 by 2050 from 8.5%. So substantial doubling will be there. And in addition, aging also will also ensure that substantial number of aged people are living in India. The proportion of people aged 75 and above is expected to increase by 340% between 2011 and 2050. This dramatic change in demography in India will need Indian healthcare system and Indian policymakers to direct the investment and their healthcare services to the disease, to managing diseases and also preventing diseases of aging population, which will require substantive investment. So let us see what are the findings. I'll take you directly to the issues which are relevant for our discussion. Chronic health conditions. This assessment of burden of chronic health conditions such as cardiovascular disease, diabetes, chronic respiratory disease, bone disease and cancers, as well as the risk factors are important for promoting appropriate and effective healthcare policies for the prevention and control of non-communicable diseases. There is lack of population-based estimates for India and states and UTs. So this study gives a specific finding. This is the self-reported prevalence of diagnosed chronic health conditions among elderly aged 60 and above. Can among the most prevalent 34.6% is cardiovascular disease, 32% is hypertension, 18% are any bone and joint disease, 14% are diabetes, any chronic lung disease is 8.3%, heart disease is 5.2%, anemia is 4.7%, stroke 2.7%, neurological psychiatric problem 2.6%, high cholesterol 2.5%, and cancer 0.7%. This is the actual data coming from this study. Then other studies will show further evaluation of this finding. I'll take you now to organ-related diseases. This is a self-reported prevalence of diagnosed organ-related diseases among elderly age 60 and above from the study. So number one problem will be any eye problem, that is 55%, cataracts is 23%, from 19%, complete edentulism 11.2%, any hearing or ear-related problem 9.6%, any urogenital condition 7.7%. This shows what should be the specialties that would like to be, that would be developed for tackling problems of aging. Now, these two graphs I would like to show to you. One is this. This is prevalence of diagnosed major chronic health condition among older adults by age. Now, age group is shown at the bottom in terms of 5 years. It goes up to 75 plus. On the left is below 45 years. If you see below 45 years, the lowest and highest as we go along, it increases from on all the parameters. If you look at parameters, the dark red is hypertension, yellow is diabetes mellitus, green is bone and joint disease, blue is cardiovascular disease, light red is chronic lung disease, and gray is neurological or psychiatric condition. Now, if you look at the top, it is cardiovascular disease rising to 37.5%, how it increases in a very fast manner from age 55 onwards, especially above 60 years. And above 60 years, again, you find hypertension increasing suddenly. Also, you find bone and joint disease increasing suddenly and then falling after 74 years. In diabetes mellitus also, you find gradual rise. But if you look at this, this Indian population has shown rise from year 50 years of age. So diabetes starts showing and increasing substantially from 50 years of age in our Indian population. And if you look at this, this is chronic lung disease. This also gets start worsening from age 50 and substantially age 65 onwards, it is sudden rise. There's another graph I would like to show, that is multi-morbidity. This is the graph. This is multi-morbidity condition as percentage among older adults by age in India. No morbidity is at the top with blue. It keeps on decreasing as single morbidity increases, but multi-morbidity increases substantially. So people will have multiple diseases and conditions as they age. So this is the issue. That means they need multimodal modality and multi-speciality care. It would not be one particular specialty which will serve the purpose of the elderly in India. It requires certain multiple specialties for managing this. Now, this is also reflective. It is the prevalence of diagnosed heart disease and symptom-based prevalence of angina pectoris among the elderly age 60 and above. In rural and urban, if you see, the difference is quite visible. Amongst male and female is also quite visible. And total, if you see, symptom-based prevalence of angina pectoris is higher than the self-report prevalence of diagnosed heart disease. So this is also throwing light as to what should be the strategy to manage the heart disease. So another area which is important in as people age is injury and or fall among older adults by age. So as injury is in the red and fall is in the blue. So as people age, injuries also rise, but falls rise much faster after 65 years suddenly, 65 to 70 years of age. And they continue to rise from, if you see at 45, 16, while it become 21.8 at 60 years of age. So there's a steady increase in the percentage of falls among the persons who age. So with time, this frequency increases. So we need to devise ways in which these falls and injuries could be prevented and managed. Another interesting graph is this graph. This is the prevalence of high blood pressure, undiagnosed hypertension, controlled and uncontrolled hypertension among older adults aged 45 and above by age, place of residence, and sex. So if you look at this is high blood pressure, this is undiagnosed hypertension, this is controlled hypertension, and uncontrolled hypertension is green. Now, if you look at 45 to 50 and more than 60, all the components increase substantially. High blood pressure, 26 to 37, undiagnosed hypertension, 17 to 21, and controlled hypertension from 12 to 17, but uncontrolled hypertension from 7 to 14, double. And the other differences are also quite visible. But this and this is important. Age 60 and above and age 45 to 59. Very crucial age. That means we need to devise programs for monitoring hypertension and managing hypertension and diagnosing early and ensuring that people have access to managing hypertension and treatment modalities for controlling hypertension on a long-term basis, not only during their working lifespan. If we have to ensure that their organs are protected. Otherwise, this is going to blow up and lead to higher deaths and a lot of preventable mortality and morbidity, right? So one would that this study throws light on the need for devising programs, policies, and strategies for managing aging population. So an institute like National Institute on Aging in USA need to be set up in India. Otherwise, we will be caught off guard. We will not have, and we will not have substantial resource-based strategy to manage the population of elderly people. So now I would like to go to another area which would be important for us to realize is what we consider important areas from in the context of what evidence has come in the last 1 month through new research published in the most read, most impactful journal in occupational medicine. That is Occupational Medicine Journal, that is Society of Occupational Medicine Journal, published by Oxford Medical. Now, this one study which came up, and I want to show you what it has shown. This is this article, which is published in Occupational Medicine Journal. In recent years, there has been a rise in the numbers of diagnosed cases of occupational asthma after years of declining numbers. This study, if I click, you will find the abstract opening up and what this says. This says, occupational asthma is estimated to be the cause of around 1 in 6 of all new cases of adult asthma diagnosed in the UK. And after years of a declining number of reported cases, recent years have seen a rise in number of diagnosed cases. But why is this happening? Suggestions include changes to reporting, a temporary statistical blip, and a variety of other reasons, making this a complex issue. Given the lack of clarity, we thought it'd be useful to ask the views of frontline clinicians undertaking statutory respiratory surveillance for occupational asthma. So this study throws light on causes which are not generally thought to be amenable to diagnosis. What is happening? The contribution of occupational environment is increasing in terms of, so that means allergens are increasing, which is leading to higher number of cases of occupational asthma. Another study which would be useful is, which has come out in the last 1 month, is this study. This study is, it says key factors associated with poorer work engagement include inadequate sleep, psychological distress, and a history of workplace bullying. These are modifiable factors that can be targeted to improve work engagement. So let us see. It is a Malaysian study, a very good study, which throws light on Malaysian employees' psychological and work-related factors predicting work engagement in Malaysian employees. Now, this shows that key factors associated with poorer work engagement in Malaysian employees include inadequate sleep, psychological distress, and a history of workplace bullying. These are modifiable factors that individuals and employers can target to improve work engagement, ideally tailored according to occupational type. So this is an important evidence which has come out from this Malaysian study, which has thrown light in terms of job permanency and longer sleep duration, low psychological distress, and no history of workplace bullying. So if these modifiable factors are implemented, it is likely that the workplace environment will improve. The third article, which has come out in the latest issue, is this article. It highlights the impact of COVID-19 on ICU staff Nearly half of the staff polled reported symptoms compatible with PTSD, depression, or problem drinking, with 1 in 7 reporting thoughts of self-harm. So this is important that this evidence in amongst ICU staff, healthcare workers, the occupational risks are higher during COVID-19. And this, as you know, mental health of staff working in ICU during COVID-19, this particular article published on 13 January throws substantive light. If you look at the conclusion, it says substantial rates of probable mental health disorders and thoughts of self-harm amongst ICU staff. These difficulties were especially prevalent in nurses. So whilst further work is needed to better understand the real level of clinical need amongst ICU staff, these results indicate the need for a national strategy to protect the mental health and decrease the risk of functional impairment of ICU staff whilst they carry out their essential work during COVID-19. So this is important evidence that we need to institute urgent, immediate, effective mental health management measures for not only medical, but also paramedical workers who are engaged in providing ICU care during COVID-19 and pandemic. Now, I would like to turn your attention to an important area of environmental health. This is a study which has come out where they have concluded that air quality is worse in smaller towns in Indo-Gangetic Plains compared to bigger cities. This study was done by Center for Science and Environment in New Delhi. And this synchronized rise in bad air days due across the region, that is Northern Indo-Gangetic Plain, which covers 26 cities of Indo-Gangetic Plain. What are the observations? There are 5 observations. While several bigger cities like Delhi or Varanasi have witnessed reduction in annual PM2.5 levels, smaller towns and cities like Fatehabad near Kanpur or Muradabad have seen an increase. Dramatic buildup in smaller towns like Hisar and Jind in Haryana happened only during November, indicating the influence of stubble burning. Third is air quality got more toxic with the onset of winter. Share of tinier PM2.5 in PM10 increased. Number of days in which PM2.5 levels met the standard was considerably lower this winter, more poor days this winter in the region. This reaffirms why air quality management requires a regional approach to implement clean air action plans with speed, scale, and urgency. This is important to understand that it is a wrong to conclude that air quality improvement only in metro cities will result in any substantive change. It requires attention to smaller cities and towns as well. If the results all across the area improve. Now, if you look at this, you would realize that this particular study has shown light on issues which are generally neglected in our study of environment. And it affects all of us as citizens and all of us as workers as well. So it has implications on occupational health as well as environmental health. And this is the interface, as I showed last month, the influence of air quality on disease prevalence, including cancers and ischemic heart disease and stroke and lung disease was shown last month through an article published in Lancet, which was a substantive article showing evidence over the last 20 years. And it was published in collaboration with the ICMR, Government of India, and number of large institutions. And more than 1,000 institutions and people were involved. Now this study, this graph, as you would be seeing, shows you percentage of change in PM2.5 annual average in the endocrinic plane of cities. If you look at the cities at the bottom, they include the entire who's who of cities in North India, right up to Gaya, Varanasi, and Muzaffarpur, Delhi, Hisar, Sirsa, Haryana, and Kanpur, Amritsar, Punjab, Haryana, UP. So this shows how things get worse. So percentage change in annual PM 2.5, Fatehabad 34%, Bathinda 14%, Agra 9%. So this shows this is the mean average. Now, this is also important. This is difference in winter pollution buildup, 2020 winter versus 2019 winter. These are monthly averages. And green is 19 and dark green is August 20 and November black in November 20. The darker one is 20, lighter one is 19. So if you look at the graph in general, you find 2020 was worse than 2019.
Dr. Jain sir, we can't see the slides.
You're not able to see the slide?
Yeah, I can only see the title of the paper which you're presenting.
All right. I'll show you that. Now, can you see? Now, is it visible, Dr. Yeah.
Yes.
So this is what it shows. And next is, as I was told in the conclusion, I was telling the conclusion, changing percentage share of PM 2.5 in PM 10 in Amritsar. This is from 1st March to 21 December of 2020. You would find the PM percentage is increasing as the temperature goes down. This red and light dotted line is right. Red dotted line is temperature, and red dark line is a PM percentage. So as temperature goes down, PM 2.5 percentage increases substantially. And this is not isolated. You find the same thing in Chandigarh and across cities in Indo-Gangetic plain. This evidence is available. This is shown in Patna. Same evidence is coming. The proportion of PM 2.5 versus PM 2.10 is increasing as the temperature comes down. Now, next is the Diwali day, and how hourly pollution changed on Diwali day in Lucknow is visible on this. And each city suffers because of this. And even the, which means our practices on the ground do not change with the law. Laws are not sufficient. This is in Amritsar, and this is Chandigarh. This is Patna. And bad air days, they start early compared to the last year. This is shown in Amritsar. This is rate of increase. If you look at this, black comes early. And red, if you see, this is 2020 weekly PM. This is the rate of increase, if you see. So this shows weekly rolling average. And this is the same rate of increase. Amritsar, Ambala, Lucknow, Patna, Chandigarh is almost similar. So what has happened is that this problem during 2020 has shifted substantially from metros to smaller towns and cities, which has an important bearing that this problem is going to escalate from metro cities to smaller towns and cities in northern India. So which is substantial long-term implication in terms of chronic disease increase, right? Now, again, I would share another important area. Now, this is the World Health Organization. What has happened during the last 1 month? I'll show you the broadly and which area should concern us. The World Health Organization, 28, that is yesterday, released a 10-year plan to end suffering from neglected tropical disease. This particular issue should be of concern to all occupational health physicians, because we in India, a lot of morbidity and mortality occurs amongst the working age population, but there is not enough resources or not enough attention, not enough knowledge about control of these diseases. So what WHO has devised is a new timeline for this particular area. It issues a new 10-year plan to end suffering from neglected tropical disease from 2030. These are the 20 diseases which affect more than a billion mainly poor people and which thrive in areas where access to quality healthcare services, clean water, and sanitation is scarce. Now, targets. Targets include eradication of guinea worm and yaws and 90% reduction. Sorry for the disturbance. So what is the target for 2030? It is reduced by 90% the number of people requiring treatment for neglected tropical disease, at least 100 countries to have eliminated at least one neglected tropical disease, eradicate two diseases, that is dracunculiasis and yaws, and reduce by 75% the disability adjusted life years related to neglected tropical disease. At the moment, this should suffice, but it'll be useful to get this document downloaded and have a view, or at least at the executive summary, that is this document ending non-neglected tropical disease together towards 2030. Okay, and then this particular document should throw light for the people who may be interested in knowing more about this particular issue. Another interesting happening which happened in the last 1 month at the World Health Organization level. On 25th of January, WHO announced development of new guidance on hepatitis C self-testing. As you know, hepatitis C is a substantive issue in India. Amongst all the countries, we have the highest population who is diagnosed and are suffering from hepatitis C infection and ultimately liver failure and cancer. This particular issue is important because this gives a kind of method for people to test for themselves whether they are suffering from hepatitis C testing. Now, I would like your attention to be drawn to next issue, which is this. WHO had issued guidelines on establishing a poison center on 18 January 2021. As you know, poisoning is a significant global public health problem. As WHO estimated in 2016, unintentional poisoning caused 1,6683 deaths and the loss of 6.3 million years of healthy life, which is disability adjusted life years. In many countries, poisoning is one of the main causes of emergency attendance at hospital. So poisoning is a time dependent emergency, and like infectious diseases, may require a specialist for appropriate diagnosis and treatment. The guidelines for establishing a poison center They provide information on the services that may be offered by a poison center, as well as detailed practical guidance on planning and operations. It is earlier, this publication was issued in 1997. So new guidelines have come, which is 2021, which also adheres to implementation of international health regulations, as well as development in technology and experience in poison centers operations since 1997. So if you just click on this guidelines for establishing poison center, you would get the new document, which is freely downloadable, 2.5 MB guidelines for establishing a poison center. And this will update all of us occupational health practitioners in establishing a state-of-the-art, globally aligned a poison center at the workplace and in the healthcare facilities. So this is quite interesting, and it will also give you capacity for surveillance, detection, and response to public health events caused by chemicals. So it's a must read for all occupational health practitioners. Now, leaving World Health Organization, let's go to the International Labor Organizations. What happened during the last 1 month in the context of labor activities and in terms of occupational health in at the level of International Labor Organization, because India is a member of ILO and also contributes substantively for its working. I would like your attention to be drawn to important events, which important areas which should draw attention to occupational health practitioners. As you know, 2021 International Year for the Elimination of Child Labor has been declared. Child labor had decreased by 38% in the last decade, but 152 million children are still affected. And India is a substantive contributor to this. Another area is home workers. They need to be better protected. Home workers constitute a substantive population of working population in our country. And this is neglected area in occupational health as well. And this number is going to increase due to COVID-19 pandemic as well. Working conditions likely to deteriorate further. So ILO has released on home workers. So this is what I wanted to tell you from the world of work and world of health. And this particular issue will come again and again. But I would request all our viewers and attendees to visit International Institute of Population Sciences website, and also see that LASI study is downloaded and studied in a more substantive way. Longitudinal aging study throws new light on the problem that all of us should be capable to manage. In the end, I would like to share with you one of the important art and occupational article in Occupational Medicine Journal. I'll just read it out for you. The work, it is hard, and the wages are low, and rises get smaller and fewer. If you want to keep eating, you will have to be beating the work of the Durham Big Hewer. Then away with you, man, and see if you can do the work of the Durham Big Hewer. Even McCall has written this. This is the Big Hewer assumed mythical status when coal mining became mechanized, a symbol of pride for the miners and their communities. This is interesting article for light reading before you go to sleep. And it will be, it's a PDF downloadable. and it gives you interesting reading. This is the Big Hoover, radio balled by Ewan McCall and Peggy Seeger and Charles Parker. So this would make you make the end of the day nice and good. In the end, I would request Shivang to play one song from YouTube, So Sorry, from the So Sorry serial. I will stop screen sharing and request Shivang to share that 2-minute song. Yeah.
Three. जिसका हमें था इंतजार, जिसके लिए सब थे बेकरार, वैक्सीन वो आ गई, सबको लगनी है और सबको लगवाना है, कोई छूटे ना कोई भी रह जाना है। इन पे क्या गुजरी तुम क्या जानो, कुछ तो सोचो ओ दीवानो, वैक्सीन पे ना भ्रम फैलाओ, लगवा लो वैक्सीन मेरी मानो, बीजेपी की वैक्सीन भरोसा ना जताएंगे, जीतेंगे इलेक्शन तब हम फिर लगवाएंगे वैक्सीन ना भाई रे ना। फिर भी हमें तो तुमको समझाना है, सबको लगनी है और सबको लगवाना है, जिसका हमें था इंतजार, जिसके लिए सब थे बेकरार, वैक्सीन आ गई, सबको लगनी है और सबको लगवाना है, कोई छूटे ना कोई भी रह जाना है, समझे?
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ajit Jain, sir. This was a nice elaboration of the whole occupational health related events which have occurred in last 1 month, and many things which if we see individually we may miss, but OcuHealth Escapes, it gives a broad perspective of what we are supposed to do as a occupational physician. And you have touched a very important topic of COVID-19 vaccine status in India right now, and the various aspects like aging and then chronic health conditions and other things which need to be taken care of in case of aging, and then various important articles and journals, these studies which have been published in different journals, they have also been elaborated by you, sir, why occupational health asthma is on rise in UK, or the psychological factors for poor work engagement, especially this Malaysian study, and the impact of COVID-19 in ICU staff. So as occupational physician and as an IUH personnel, it is also our responsibility to go in these particular aspects, and if we can guide Indian population based on some key takeaways which we get from these studies, if we can implement them in India for the benefit of our Indian workforce, that will be a good takeaway from today's occupational health escapes, and especially these guidelines on establishing a poisoning center. So many chemical industries, they may like to establish these poisoning centers, which will be helpful for them. And this WHO release on the neglected tropical disease, that is also a very important aspect. So if we can take up some of these studies, and we can do something in India, that will be helpful for our Indian population, our Indian workforce. So it was a great session from you, sir. And there's one question from Dr. Bobby Sosa. If I would read it out for you, sir. That is regarding your presentation, sir. That it was thought-provoking as always. And his question is related to the Lassie report. What are the implications to our specialty? What are the interventions that you would recommend for our working population in order to promote healthy aging in our workforce? Especially given the job profiles of most of our 600 million workers. From Dr. Bobby Joseph. So, Dr. Joseph, you can unmute yourself. You can directly ask any other question if you have from Dr. Rajiv.
Thanks, Dr. Sandeep, for asking that question on my behalf. But basically, I was just wondering whether we as a group have got any ideas as to what we should be doing for our current working population in order to prevent those multiple morbidities which Dr. Rajiv Jain was enlisting. Are there any strategies which we can think of? Does Dr. Rajiv know of any strategies which have been implemented in other parts of the world which we should start doing now? Thank you.
Yes, very interesting question, Dr. Bobby. And this was precisely the reason why this study was actually instituted. And this is not the end. In fact, this is only the beginning. As I told you, it is wave one. Wave one means that we have now evidence at the beginning of the intervention. The intervention is going to start through the National Program for Healthy Aging. And in that context, the national program, which is PMJAY, has already started the health and wellness centers for the unorganized sectors, where intervention will start at the working age population and especially focused towards unorganized people. If you look at the safety and occupational health codes, the way they're going to go ahead is they're going to target the neglected 92%, not the, in the past 8% were attended to. Now the focus will shift to preventing non-communicable disease in the working population, in the unorganized sector, through an organized IT-based resource center where we will generate data on real-time basis, and intervention will be scaled up in the context of the increasing evidence that India is facing the explosion or epidemic of non-communicable diseases, especially hypertension, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes, in addition to cancer, which originates in the working age population. So unless intervention is done during working age, no substantive benefit is going to happen in the aging population. So what is being tried at is to gather evidence as to what works and what does not work, and that whatever works, whatever intervention works, scale it up fast through a framework of continuous data collection and scaling up interventions on a large basis, which will not be restricted to only pilot studies, which will be actually scaled up all across the country. So that is what is planned, and that is what is being started already. If you, I don't know whether you're aware that when the health minister released this wave one study during the pandemic this last week, he was underscoring this fact only. Dr. Harshvardhan said that we will, he was saying that we'll get the funding for gathering more evidence so that this becomes part of our program implementation. And not only the Ministry of Health, the large number of ministries would be converging their interventions through the health and wellness centers. And then PMJY will be impinging. So it is not only treatment, the focus will shift to prevention and wellness management.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jain. Thank you.
So other panelists, sir, if you all have any question or some comment, then you can unmute yourself or again raise your hand as well. I can ask Dr. Srinivas Shanbhag, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Sandeep. First of all, compliments, Dr. Jain. As usual, thought-provoking. A lot of research goes into this. I don't know how much time you spend on that, but outstanding. to open our eyes, and this is what it is. So I think, you know, education to all occupational health physician is good, great, and you are doing a great job out of it. Compliments to you as well as AEOHD, IOH Delhi. Thank you very much, Sandeep, for giving me an opportunity.